So Vibrio parahemolyticus is the most common cause of seafood-borne illness in the U.S. It's most often associated with the consumption of raw and undercooked shellfish, and usually oysters. And that's because they're often eaten raw, which means they're not subject to a kill step like a lot of other foods. For example, if you had bought some chicken at the supermarket that had salmonella on it, as long as you cook it to the required temperature, you're not going to get sick. But with oysters, very often, they're delicious when they're not cooked. So they're not going to be subject to that kill step. So in food safety research, there's a lot of emphasis on identifying conditions when foodborne pathogens are likely to come into contact with high-risk foods like this, and how to prevent that from occurring and how to treat and remove pathogens if they end up there. So the symptoms of Vibrio parahemolyticus infection are just like that of most foodborne pathogen infections: diarrhea, nausea, vomiting. But in some cases, it can be very serious and lead to septicemia and death. So again, it's an important area of research to focus on prevention and treatment of these infections. We also know that pathogenic Vibrio have moved around the world in multiple waves. But particularly since 1998, we've seen more virulent strains moving quickly around the world and causing infections. And of the major foodborne pathogens, Vibrio is the only group that is clearly increasing in incidence, possibly because of these new and more virulent strains, and also because of our warming waters that are expanding both the geographic and the temporal range of where these Vibrio can survive and thrive. So at the same time that we're seeing rising temperatures, we're also seeing rising pollution of microplastics. Microplastics are ubiquitous in marine environments, particularly in coastal areas, and plastic pollution can harbor a rich microbial community on their surface that may include Vibrio species at higher concentrations than in water. So our graduate student, Kara Wiggin, is leading a project to examine whether microplastics can act as a significant vector of Vibrio parahemolyticus to oysters. Oysters can eat microplastics, which are covered in these biofilms. And although those microplastics may not stay in the oyster for a long time, they're covered in these living biofilms, so their influence may remain, either due to the microplastic direct influence on the host or due to indirect effects by the microbiome. So our initial results are showing that, yes, we do see that Vibrio strains are forming biofilms on different types of plastic, and this biofilm formation is higher at higher temperatures and variable by strain. So we've worked with colleagues from several different locations that are working with Vibrio and oysters to develop a culture collection of isolates from the environment and also from outbreaks of disease in people. So we're repeating this experiment with a lot of different conditions to try to see what trends we can pull out. We're using different types of plastic, other substrates like wood, many different environmental and clinical strains, and looking for these patterns. The next phase of this research takes plastics colonized by Vibrio parahemolyticus and feeds them to oysters. So we're comparing uptake of Vibrio parahemolyticus strains to oysters when they're either provided in the water or provided on microplastics, and quantifying if there's a difference there using culture-based and DNA-based methods. And so far, we've completed experiments with a couple of different strains, and we found, again, that the results are strain-specific. So with the first strain, microplastics did enhance uptake of Vibrio, and this was an environmental non-pathogenic strain of Vibrio parahemolyticus. But in another strain, a clinical strain, the uptake was statistically similar whether the microplastics were there or not. So we only have one environmental and one clinical strain. So again, it's really important that we're able to repeat this research with many different strains and start to find out why certain strains are behaving in different ways. And here's just a snapshot of the vast diversity of Vibrio parahemolyticus. So you've heard me mention non-pathogenic and pathogenic. So it's a very diverse species where, yes, some can make us sick and some just happen to be in the environment and are not going to make us sick. So it makes it really challenging to study, because if you're just testing for Vibrio parahemolyticus, it's hard to know if that's pathogenic or not. So these types of lab-based experiments are really, really important to start to tease apart, okay, how conserved are these impacts across the phylogenetic tree of Vibrio parahemolyticus, or is it really specific to just clinical strains or just environmental strains or a mix of both? What can we learn about what are the biggest risks here for human health and also for the industry? So the next steps are to address that. What determines whether a strain attaches better on plastic and transmits better to an oyster? So we're also planning on expanding these experiments to acknowledge that the plastics that are circulating out in the ocean, we know that they're not sterile. They're covered in a microbial community as well, and that's where the Vibrio is taking part of the biofilm. So we're also planning experiments to introduce a more complex microbiome and see how the Vibrio dynamics change there in terms of both attachment and uptake. Oysters are one of the most important organisms for aquaculture. They're a relatively low input and healthy form of protein and sustenance. They support our coastal economies. And native oysters, actually, which are pretty abundant around our coasts, can filter and clean our water up to 50 gallons a day of both chemical and microbial contaminants. But this filtering is another thing that makes them really interesting to study if we're considering them as a source of food. Sure, it's great that they're cleaning all the water by filtering chemical and microbial contaminants, but how might that affect our exposure risk if we eat those oysters? So one thing that I find really exciting about oysters is they relate to so many sustainable development goals. By being a less resource-intensive food that doesn't require any added feed beyond what's already in the ocean, and actually cleaning the water more than polluting it, it's contributing to multiple of these goals, supporting the economy, and also being a healthy, low-fat source of protein, omega-3s, iron, zinc, and vitamin B12. They can contribute to good health and well-being. So oysters, fantastic future direction. So in our lab, we use a variety of techniques to study oysters, a mix of field studies and lab-based studies. So it's really important to study what's going on in the environment in terms of our local conditions and our local oysters. But in the lab, you have a lot more control over the different factors and how they're all interrelated, because they really are all interrelated. So I'm going to start by discussing some of our field research that was led by Dr. Rachel Diner, who is a postdoc in our lab and has now just started her own lab at the University of Memphis. Here she is out collecting samples with some of our graduate and undergraduate students, Zach, Emily, and Yash. Rachel collected samples from Newport Bay from several different locations and looked at both oyster and water microbiomes over the course of a few time points. Despite the fact that the water microbiomes were pretty different, so if you look at this graph, the thing to pay attention to is the different points and how close they are to each other or how far apart. So each dot represents a sample, and if those dots are closer together, that means they share more similar microbial communities, and if they're farther apart, that means that their microbial communities are a little bit different. And you can tell which samples are which by the color codes we have here. So if you just look at the orange dots, you can see that there's kind of two clusters of water samples. And the ones on the bottom are clustering separately, and those turned out to be higher salinity water. So we're seeing there that the higher salinity water has a little bit of a different microbiome compared to the lower salinity waters. But when we look at the oysters, they're all pretty similar to each other regardless of where they came from. So this is a pretty interesting finding, suggesting that the water is more changeable in response to those environmental conditions than the oysters. But we have an ongoing study expanding the geography of this a little bit and the time of this a little bit to look between Newport Bay and San Diego Bay and over a longer time period to further tease apart these dynamics. Further results from this study showed that it's not that the oyster microbiome is completely independent from the water. We actually did see that specific bacteria were correlated between the water and the oysters. In particular, when we saw high levels of potentially pathogenic vibrio bacteria in the water, we also saw high levels in the oysters. And we also found that these higher levels of potential pathogens were correlated with higher temperature, higher salinity, and higher overall microbial diversity. So this is another reason why in our lab we're really interested in studying oysters, not just for their incredible potential as a sustainable food source, but also because there is some risk associated with eating them, and they are tied to foodborne disease,